I'm Ed Lazowska. I've been a faculty member here for, God, 35 years, and it's great to have you here. I want you to know that we want your great students who are interested in math and science. They don't have to have taken high school programming. It's great if they have. Alen Martin, who talked to you earlier, was the CS teacher at Garfield for a couple of years. Before that, she was an undergrad of ours, so she understands what you folks and your teachers do and what your students do. And so we're really eager to engage. In this department, 85% of our students are from Washington State. They're unbelievably great students, and I'll say more about that in a minute. I'm also going to give you an answer to one of the questions that you were asked. Remember, there's sort of four reasons you were told for why these companies are interested in diversity. Most of them aren't great reasons for me. You know, so there is the social equity reason. These are great jobs. We should have more people in them. I buy that. There's the workforce issue. If we had more people slaving away in the salt mines, we'd have more salt. That's sort of a crass reason. Here's what I think the big one is, okay? People doing computer science are engaged in something that's inherently creative. They're designing things for people to use. And each of us brings our own perspective, our own baggage to anything that we do, all right? And if you're involved in a creative design process and you don't have the full breadth of experiences involved, then you wind up with a worse product, okay? So even the hardest-hearted, most sort of selfish capitalist ought to be able to understand that a more diverse computing workforce creates a better result, okay? Something that is more useful to more people more of the time. This may or may not be true for highways. I don't know about that. Years ago, during the last tech boom, somebody from the New York Times interviewed me and asked how come everybody was majoring in computer science as opposed to other engineering fields. And, you know, I talked to this reporter for 20 minutes, and the only sentence he quoted was, because there's only so much you can do with asphalt. That, of course, got me email from every civil engineer in the country, but okay. So it's not so clear for roads, but it's really clear for computer systems, for computer applications, that a diverse workforce, diverse in every way, creates something better, okay? So here's what I'm gonna claim. 40 plus years ago, there were four great things that happened. This is in 1969, and I want you to try to remember what they were. Most of you weren't born then. Well, most of you were probably born. I certainly was, okay? So what happened in 1969? What can you remember? Sorry? Man landed on the moon. Great. What else? Fantastic. Okay, there's the moon landing. We're doing great. Woodstock. You can find great stuff on the web. Okay. What else? Any baseball fans here? The Mets won the World Series for the first and last time. And the first packet was sent over the ARPANET, the precursor to today's internet, okay? The first packet was sent from UCLA to the Stanford Research Institute in California. There were four computers on the ARPANET at the time. So I guess this computer network that now has a billion computers on it had four computers on it, all right, the predecessor of it. And it was intended not for email or the web or downloading pornography or anything like that. It was intended for sharing scarce computing resources, right? And so the first packet was a packet in which the person at UCLA was trying to log into a remote computer at SRI to use that computer remotely. And the first packet contains the characters L and O, the first two letters of login, and then the network crashed. So, you know, some things never change, but this is Charlie Klein's log of trying to make it work back then, okay? And here's the question, with 40 years of hindsight, and I apologize to Sam who's seen some of these slides before, which of these has had the greatest impact, all right? And my claim is that unless you really like Tang and Velcro, the great contributions of the space program, it's pretty clear. You know, nobody remembers anything from Woodstock, and the Mets haven't been successful since then pretty much, okay? Right? But a billion people today use the internet, right? And it's because it grows and grows and grows. Exponential means doubles in fixed periods of time, and everything about computing does that. So exponentials is something that we don't encounter in our daily lives. There's this old story about the guy who invented chess, and the pharaoh or king or whoever who he invented chess for was so grateful that he said, okay, any wish you want, I'll grant. This is such a cool game. And so the inventor of chess's wish was that he get one grain of rice, for the first square on the chessboard, and two for the second, and four for the third, and eight for the fourth, and 16 for the fifth, and so on and so forth. And the king said, sure, no problema, okay? So 1, 2, 4, 8, 128, 256, you know, pretty soon you're talking about a lot of rice, right? Right? And that's what happens when you double at fixed periods of time. So what's been happening in computing is the number of transistors that you can fit in a square centimeter has been doubling every year and a half since 1965, right? And that causes remarkable changes, okay? Processing capacity, storage capacity, network bandwidth, sensors. In fact, even the human part of this, the algorithms by which we solve problems, have been on this same pace of change. And that's not driven by transistor density or optics or anything like that. It's driven by smart people figuring out better ways to solve problems. Okay? And so when you have this sort of thing, it gives you two capabilities. One is you can get constant performance, constant capability at an exponentially decreasing cost. Right? So a certain amount of memory will cost you half as much in a year and a half as it costs you today. Right? Alternatively, you can get exponentially improving capability at constant cost, right? So a million instructions per second, if you will, right? Or a gigabyte of disk costs you $100 today, and it will cost you $50 in a year and a half, and $25 in another year and a half. Just keeps going down by half. Get the idea? Okay. And this always catches us off guard, because almost nothing in our natural world has this characteristic, right? There are a few things. For example, many of you are from the Seattle area. You may remember the milfoil problems in Green Lake a few years ago. And what happens with milfoil is, you know, it reproduces exponentially. So originally, there's just a couple of little petals. And then it's four, and then it's eight, and it's over in some little corner of the lake. And by the time anybody notices, it's sort of kawunga, a couple of more weeks of reproducing, and you've covered the lake, and you have to get out the poison harvester, okay? But that's sort of the negative version of exponential. Computing is the positive version. So here's the result of this, all right? The mainframe computers of the type that I sort of grew up with, the computing capacity of those computers is literally now in an electronic greeting card, right? In terms of the number of millions of instructions per second the processor can deliver, okay? And the amount of computing power that got Apollo 11 to the moon, okay, back to the moon program, is literally in a Furby, okay? So this may not be the greatest social use of that capability, but it's still utterly, utterly remarkable, right? Okay, how these things have changed. And the same is true for the internet. Vint Cerf and Bob Kahn invented the internet protocols back in the 1960s and 1970s. And this is an honest to God graph of the number of internet hosts. It's a log scale versus time, all right? So it's gone from four, you know, to about a billion. UW was one of the first 200 computers on the ARPANET, the predecessor of the internet. That was back here in 1980 or so, right? So from then, it's gone from 200 to a billion. Most people didn't notice it until 1995 or so. The web came along and stuff like that. But the truth is, the number of computers on the internet had been more or less, if that was a dead straight line, okay, doubling at fixed periods of time since 1969, when we had that little napkin drawing with four, okay? And so now, what's happened in the most recent 10 years? In 2010, or you know, December 2009, I, like everybody else, was asked to say, okay, so what's happened in the past 10 years? And I claimed that all of these things were totally different in 2010 than in 2000. They were barely on the radar screen, right? You know, your media was analog, okay, or at the very least, CDs. It's not like you got it over the web. You weren't connected everywhere you go, for better or for worse, right? You know, we didn't have the cloud, we didn't have e-commerce in any significant way, sort of on and on. Remember, Amazon only sort of burst forth in 95 or 96. It was just a complete niche, okay? And here's what's happening in the next decade. This is what computer science does. We're putting the smarts into everything, into homes, cars, bodies, robots, science, which is what I work on, sort of data-driven discovery, crowds, interaction, like Kinect. I could spend, you know, hours giving you examples of all of these. Let me just touch on a few. You know, if you think about homes, for example, we have a person in this department, Shwetik Patel, and he and his students build sensors that tell you exactly how much energy every device in your home is consuming. And it's a little sensor that just plugs into the wall in one place. It's unbelievably cool, okay? And here's how it works. I've lied a bit. There's actually a second piece. There's an ammeter, and that's how much power you're drawing, all right? So, you know, your house has a 200 amp service probably, and the amount you're drawing goes from, you know, 17 amps up to maybe 150 amps if you've got an electric furnace or something like that, right? It goes up and down. And then the other box, the one that you plug into the wall anywhere, right, it uses noise on the power line as the signal. Every time you flip a switch, it puts a little spike on the line. Every time an electric motor is running, it modulates the line. Every time a compact fluorescent is running or a Panasonic 50-inch flat panel, it puts noise on the line, and you can detect those distinct noise patterns, right? And determine that the TV must have gone on or the dishwasher must have gone on, okay? If you're a rich person and have two 50-inch Panasonic flat panels, then they are different wire run lengths from where you happen to plug this thing in, and that changes the signal somewhat. Get the idea, right? So that's a piece of the smart home. And the goal is to present you this information in a way that you can change your behavior, right? He's got the same thing for water. Both of these things are being commercialized by a company called Belkin right now. For water, if you live in an older house, when your dishwasher goes on and off, or its washing machine goes on and off, you hear the pipes sort of clunk, all right? So what that indicates to you is that every time a valve opens or closes in your home water system, there's a pressure transient that goes through the piping in your house, okay? So the sensor here is a little rubber diaphragm that you thread over a hose bib that you're not using. And then you turn the nozzle on, so your home water system is pressing against this rubber diaphragm. And when you flush the toilet, it goes wubble, 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 like that, okay? And it has a little coil behind it, and it generates an electric current. And every different valve generates a different signal, and you can tell exactly who's using water. The idea? So that's just an example of the smart home. Here's what I mean by smart bodies. I always wonder how come our bodies are so much worse instrumented than our cars, right? You go in to your auto dealer every year or so for service, and the mechanic, who's no longer greasy, it's probably a she and she's dressed cleanly, plugs in a computer under the dash and reads out the last 6 months of data and figures out if you have any problems, and if so, fixes them, right? You go in to see your physician, she says, where does it hurt? This can't make sense, right? And it's not the way things are going to be in another few years, right? You're going to have constant monitoring of your systems, and your physician will have access to this so that she can intervene sort of preemptively, right? And sort of on down the line. And what computer science is doing is putting the smarts into all of this stuff. So this is our view of the field. The traditional thing that you think of as computer science, that's operating systems and networks and programming languages, the stuff I've been doing for 35 years, that's that little thing we call core computer science in the middle. This doesn't sit too well with many computer science faculty members because they realize that they're just in that little thing in the middle that's not differentiated, okay? But the real story, as you were hearing, is that if you want progress in any of these global challenge and national challenge areas, then you need progress in computer science, right? And the way we hook core computer science to things like the smart world, right, or improved transportation systems, or lower cost, higher efficacy healthcare, is through those little greenish blobs in the middle, through things like human-computer interaction and machine learning and cloud computing and big data, right? So where we've been hiring faculty in this department in recent years is in these areas, and as I've indicated, we have stories, many of them collaborative stories with other people at UW, in all of these surrounding areas, and almost all of this work involves undergraduates, not just graduate students. The faculty don't do anything except give talks, right? All the work is done by the students, and there's intensive engagement of undergrads in research here, okay? So there are jobs, and I say this not to emphasize it too much, but just because there's this myth out there that there are not jobs in computing, or if they are, they're all going to move to India, all right? So this is Bureau of Labor Statistics data for job availability in the various STEM fields, okay, between 2010 and 2020. So the green columns are newly created jobs in this decade, and the blue columns are newly created jobs plus jobs available due to refreshes, retirements, right? So if you look at this, this is computing, all the rest of engineering, electrical, mechanical, civil, chemical, industrial, blah, blah, okay. Life science, right? Biology, the environmental sciences, on physics, chemistry, right? All of the social sciences, okay? 70% of all the new jobs in this decade and 60% of all available jobs in all STEM fields, regardless of whether they're refills or new jobs, are in computing, right? And 85% of both are in the sum of computer science and other fields of engineering. And if you come away with nothing else from this, I want you to understand that these are creative fields that are great for everybody. This is where the college degrees are, okay? Everybody's majoring in sociology and psychology. Great. You know, I have a kid who runs Starbucks stores, and he is thrilled that people are getting bachelor's degrees in sociology and psychology because he needs them to be doing stuff for him for 10 bucks an hour. Finally, implications for K-12 education. Right? Have any of you seen this report or heard of it? This is a famous 1983 report by a presidential commission on the state of education in this country. And here's the money quote. It said, if an unfriendly foreign power had attempted to impose on America the mediocre educational performance that exists today, we might well have viewed it as an act of war. As it stands, we've allowed this to happen to ourselves. Okay, so this is a report mostly about STEM education. They actually recommended in 1983 that to graduate from high school, a student should have a half year of computer science. Now, a half year isn't much, but what was computing in 1983? Okay, it was a PC XT with 128K of RAM running PC DOS.
Was it had okay?
There were not cards on this. No, there was a keyboard, but mainframes had cards, certainly. Okay, so this is a pretty visionary report for 1983. How much progress have we made in 30 years? Okay, this is the new report from the National Academies last year, right? Framework for K-12 science education. Okay, 400-page report, 15-page index. Here's some stuff from the index. You want to know about energy? Boy, we got energy covered. And we point you to force and motion. We got that covered too. You want to know about computer science? There it is. All right? And most of those references are pointers to places in the text where they explain why they didn't include it despite people telling them they should. Okay? So we've gone backwards in 30 years, right? Because STEM policy, STEM education, science policy in this nation is honestly controlled by the chemists, physicists, biologists, and astronomers, and they don't want no interlopers, right? But our argument is that there are fundamentals of computer science. Those fundamentals are things like algorithmic analysis, problem solving, that's what we teach, right? These are things that every 21st century person needs to know, and the way we teach those things is by programming. Okay, programming is a valuable skill, but it's also the hands-on, inquiry-based way we teach what we call computational thinking. And every student needs to know this, and we've got to figure out how to do it. That report, of course, generated next-generation science standards, which we're all now implementing and which have no computer science in them. Today, 9 out of 10 high schools don't offer computer science. In 36 of the 50 states, even if it's there, you don't get academic credit for it. You don't get a math or science graduation credit. Several other states have just flipped due to pressure. I'll talk about it in a sec. And Washington a few months ago flipped. But I have to say that the University of Washington doesn't know exactly how it's going to count this. I mean, certainly I don't want students to take less math in order to take computer science, right? So it's complicated, but the fact is computational thinking is a key capability for every 21st century citizen, and we've got to figure out how to crack this. So here are a couple of things to point you to. Code.org is a phenomenal organization launched by Hadi Partovi. These slides are on the web. Don't write it down. I'll show you where to get them, okay? And it is pushing very hard to drive changes in all 50 states. You'll see a lot about this. One of their initiatives is to beef up Computer Science Education Week. Alain will tell you that we have an open house every year on Computer Science Education Week. This is to coincide. It's a week that coincides with the birthday of Grace Murray Hopper, who was a Navy admiral, a very early computer programmer who coined the word bug because she was working with a relay computer and there actually was a bug that kept it from functioning properly. It was like a moth whose wing was in between the relay contacts or something like that. So that's where bug came from, okay? So we'd love to have you and your students here for our open house for CS Ed Week. And finally, we have a really vibrant outreach program for teachers and students and parents. And we'd love for you to learn more about that and participate in it. So that's a scoop. It's a great time. It's a great time for computer science. I'm, as usual, over time and I gotta go downtown, but thank you so much for being here.